sharp as a knife, Miles Hunt from the Wonder Stuff had this to say about our final band taking us home in part three. I thank Verve for keeping teenage angst alive. Ooh, put that knife back in the drawer now. But they'll be live in the comfort of your sitting room in part three, along with an interview with rising singer-songwriter Misty Oldland. I'm just going up to give Nelson the once-over. See you after the break. Welcome back to part three of The Beat. Now, I get hundreds of letters each week, people asking me to play Misty for me. Well, unfortunately, I haven't got the record, but I've got the next best thing this evening, singer-songwriter Misty Oldland. Welcome to the programme.
Thanks for having me.
Now, before we talk about what you're up to now, do you want to give us a brief potted history of what you've done before?
Oldland Montano, the whole works. I was signed to Siren Records for 3 years in a girl duo when I was about 20, but due to various technical reasons, the project didn't really happen. So recently, I decided that I'd like to put a record out myself on the sort of London underground scene, and produced it and wrote it myself, which is the single. And it got a lot of attention from the radio. Radio One, Jazz, Kiss, everyone played it, gave it a lot of support. And due to that, I got Columbia Records phoning me and offering me a deal. So we've put it out properly now through Columbia.
Sometimes it's so hard to say what you wanna say. It may seem wrong. That is why I'm telling you my secret in this song. Got me a feeling and I can't forget the meaning. Oh, you feeling it? Oh, you feeling it too?
I mean, it was important for you this time to sort of like get it right, wasn't it? Tell us how you went about putting the whole sort of project together.
Well, basically, I was running a club for a couple of years called Slow Motion, which was sort of in answer to the house thing. Sort of, everything basically was under 100 BPM, all the records, and we showcased a lot of new up-and-coming sort of London, British soul and dance acts such as Gabrielle, Jamiroquai, a lot of people like that, Martine Giraud. And through the club, I realised that that was another way you could have your music heard, and obviously every songwriter wants to have their music heard. So I thought, well, I'll do it myself, print them up myself and put them out. So that's kind of what happened. But also, obviously, Jamiroquai, Gabrielle, Lena Fiagbi now, success of British songwriters in that kind of soul vein, probably encourage them to think possibly I could follow, you know, crossover. You know, I produced it, wrote it, and I sort of had a vision, and it was really important for me to get that song sounding the way I heard it in my head. And yeah, it was incredibly satisfying, and when I got that positive response, it's given me so much confidence, and I'm overwhelmed.
I mean, it's very much an antidote to what else is happening at the moment, though. I mean, the sampling, the remixing, the overproduction.
Well, that's right. I think, but you know, with every kind of revolution of music, there's always a counter-revolution. I think the cover thing and the sampling thing had got to such a head that really it was time for songwriters to come back. And hopefully I'm on the crest of the wave.
I mean, what can we expect from the album? I mean, we've heard the single.
It's very diverse. We've got hip-hop elements, soul elements, a lover's rock tune, folk elements. They're all traditional songs. We've treated each one individually as an individual, like almost an entity. I don't bung lots of effects on my vocals. I keep them quite dry and quite upfront and quite honest sounding. So maybe that differentiates me.
Now, a lot of people are sort of like, you know, tipping you as the next big thing.
Who told you that? My PR.
And that bloke over there. Time now, groovers, to plunge headfirst into the morass that is Indie Land and join those lank-headed darlings, Verve.